Heaven Official's Blessing, Chapter 49, Audio Source, WuxiaWorldAudiobook.com. Adroit dice for the safety of only one. Seeing that he was about to walk away, Lang Qianchu immediately called out, "Stop!" Xie Lian stopped. Lang Qianchu gritted his teeth and finally ground out, "You owe me an explanation." "What kind of explanation do you want?" Xie Lian asked. "Of past grudges for our kingdom and family. It's not that I can't understand your hatred for Yang and," but he choked up. It wasn't for another moment before he continued in a strained, quivering voice, "But head priest, did my parents and I not treat the remaining citizens of Xian Lu well? I was friends with many of them, and I did my best to protect them. Every word he said was the truth. After the Xian Le kingdom had fallen, many Remang citizens never forgot their roots. And even after the Yang'an kingdom was built and started its rule, those people and their descendants continued to live on as the people of Xian Le, often clashing with people of the new kingdom. The first few generations of the Yang'an monarchy ruled with force and cruelly massacred many of the rioting Xian Le people. Inversely, there were also underground alliances formed by the Xian Le people to plot the assassination of many of the Yang'an nobility, and even succeed a few times. This continued on, and the end result was a deeply seated hatred for each other on both sides. However, with the start of the rule of Lang Qianchu's parents, the king took on a different attitude and treated the Xian Le people with kindness and compassion. He wanted to unite the country of the old and the new against all voices of dissent. Even if the idea of granting princely titles to past Xian Le royalties was absurd, he used it as a way to show his sincerity and regarded them with respect. Lang Qianchu himself had never been prejudiced because of past hatred. Everything was but history. The head priest Feng Xin then was a mysterious figure, having never revealed his true identity, so no one knew on which side stood the mastermind behind the Gilded Banquet massacre. However, the hatred between Yang'an and Xian Le ran too deep. Both sides would accuse each other whenever anything should happen. And so many of the serving nobles all pointed their fingers at Xian Le and used the chance to request for the complete annihilation of the remaining people of Xian Le. Yet, Lang Qianchu had rejected all their efforts. His determination protected the lives of many and prevented them from suffering a nameless genocide. However, now that he was reminiscing, the more good he did then, the more wronged he felt now. Not that he felt what he had done was worthless, but he felt deeply aggrieved. It's never worthless to do what you think is right, but to have shown so much benevolence without reciprocation, he couldn't help but feel wronged. Lang Qianchu's eyes reddened and continued to question, "Head priest, did I not do enough? Did my parents do something wrong? Why must you treat me like this?" The more he thought, the more vexed he became, and struggled against Ruwei's bind once more, strained to lift his upper body. "Do you not think you owe us an explanation?" "I can't give you one," Xie Lian said. The response was so direct, Lang Qianchu choked back his anger. "Head priest, you've changed so much. You were never like this before." Xie Lian rubbed his forehead and said, "I remember I've already told you long ago, not to venerate me as an incorruptible saintly figure. I'm nothing like the person in your mind. In the end you'd only disappoint yourself." Lang Qianchu laid on the ground and mumbled, "The past you or the present you, I don't know which one is the real you anymore. They're all me. But you were only 17 back then. Now that you're older, of course I'd be teaching you a different lesson," Xie Lian said. Lang Qianchu closed his mouth for a moment but then blurted, "Was it because your 17th was a trial, that you had to turn my 17th into a trial too?" Xie Lian didn't respond. Seeing that he wouldn't speak, Lang Qianchu's anger flared and took in a huge breath. He yelled, "If that was your intention, then I won't let you have your way." Xie Lian's eyes widened at those words. Lang Qianchu couldn't stand, but his eyes were bright and his tone tenacious, as if a roaring flame was blazing within his eyes. He continued, his tone harsh, like he was peeved but also like he was declaring war. If you're going to force me to abandon myself, I refuse. I will never, no matter what you do to me, I will never become like you. It was a declaration so heroic Xie Lian was becoming dazed just listening to it. It took a moment before he came to, and PFFT Ed, bursting into laughter. Lang Qianqiu's face was covered with fiery tears. His blood boiling with passion and was at the height of his zealous cries, but all that was deflated by Xie Lian's laugh, and he became angrily bewildered. Xie Lian, on the other hand, was clapping as he laughed, his laughter growing by the minute, and he cried. Good. He rubbed his eyes and nodded. Good. Remember what you said today. That you will never become like me. Hua Cheng still had his arms crossed and watched coldly. Just as Xie Lian finished speaking, there was suddenly a blast of red smoke before him. The explosion came too suddenly and Xie Lian jolted, thinking Lang Qianqiu might have used some strange trick, and immediately evaded, his gaze watchful. However, the blast was loud in sound only, and didn't pose any harm. When the smoke had cleared, Lang Qianqiu had disappeared from where he laid. What was left was a Daruma doll, one swaying left and right. The Daruma doll had a very round face and body like a giant squash. Its brows black and its expression like a tiger, cute and juvenile. At that moment it was glaring, plump with anger, and it carried a fat sword on its back, gallant in its form exactly like Lang Qianqiu, except it's a lovable big toy. Xie Lian stopped smiling and called, Qianqiu. Rue let go and returned to wrap itself around Xie Lian's wrist. Hua Cheng walked over leisurely and flicked his finger on the body of that Daruma doll, laughing. Why does he look so foolish no matter what form he takes? Xie Lian picked up the Daruma doll and didn't know whether to laugh or cry. This, San Lang, is this Qianqiu? Why did he turn into this form? Stop playing around with him and change him back. No, take him along and let's go, Hua Cheng replied. Go where? Xie Lian asked. Just then, the two had come to a cramped little cave. Hua Cheng didn't answer him. He tossed up a dice and it landed in his palm. He lowered his eyes to glance at it before entering the cave. To turn someone into a Daruma doll was such a mischievous spell as very much Hua Cheng's style, but it's also hard to undo. Either way Xie Lian couldn't unravel it, and he couldn't guarantee any other heavenly officials could do it either. So he held the doll in his hands and was just about to follow Hua Cheng when he abruptly remembered the tossed Fang Xin and doubled back to pick up the sword. He strapped it onto his back and chased after Hua Cheng. Xie Lian wanted Hua Cheng to undo the spell, but the man was non-committal. The two walked around in the cave for a bit, and soon after it became wider and more spacious than the entrance. Footsteps echoed in the cave, and some distance in front of them came a faint light and sounds of singing. When Xie Lian was led to Paradise Manor in the Ghost City, he had also heard singing, but the graceful songs of charming female ghosts were enticing and beautiful like aphrodisiac, intoxicating. The singing was like the chaotic dance of demons, appalling and hideous. The two were nothing alike. Xie Lian couldn't help but ask, San Lang, what is this place? Shish Hua Cheng lightly silenced him. Xie Lian's question was already voiced in a near whisper. Hearing the shush, he held his breath. Soon he discovered why the need to be silent. Right in front of them came bunches of floating green ghost fires. And when the little bunches of flames approached, he saw they were little demons dressed in green. On the heads of each little demon was a small flaming light, as if they themselves were a green candle. There was nowhere to hide in this cave and the path was narrow. Xie Lian was about to reach for Fang Xin, but thought Rue would be better suited in this situation, and dropped his hand again. But then, just as the little demons passed by them, they didn't bat an eyelash before moving on, continuing to whisper amongst themselves. It wasn't like they didn't see them, but more so that they didn't think it strange to see them. Xie Lian looked at Hua Cheng, and the one standing next to him wasn't the exceptionally handsome red-clothed ghost king he knew, but another little pale demon with a green flame on his head. So it seemed that Hua Cheng had changed them into fake skins without him knowing when it happened. Thinking that he himself must be upholding a green flame above his head, Xie Lian couldn't help but raise a hand to feel. Why must they transform into such a bizarre appearance? Although he trailed off, Hua Cheng obviously knew what he wanted to say. I already mentioned that the green ghost Qi Rong is vulgar and crass. All of his lackeys have to look like this. Xie Lian didn't realize that Hua Cheng had brought him to the green ghost Qi Rong's territory. Before, when the heavens and the ghost realm mentioned the green ghost Qi Rong, they all had to comment on just how uncouth he was, and Xie Lian couldn't fathom why. Now that he'd learned that all of his little demon subordinates had to dress like this, he could somewhat understand. Only by the title, the Night Touring Green Lantern, there was still a trace of sarcastic elegance, but if it was literally green light walking around at night, then there's definitely a gap between what he had in mind. Didn't you already destroy his lair? Xie Lian asked. I did, but he escaped, Hua Cheng replied. Escaped for 50 years, then built a new lair. Xie Lian held the Lengqian Chudaru medal close to this chest and whispered after making sure there was no one around. San Lang, are you here to find the Night Touring Green Lantern? Why don't you undo Chiancho's spell and let him go first, and then I'll accompany you? Hua Cheng obstinately refused. No, take him with you. I need him to meet someone. Xie Lian was curious. Hua Cheng didn't act like he cared much for Lang Chianchu, so why would he take him to meet anyone especially? But all of his options were rather awkward, so he didn't speak any more on the subject. When the two finally emerged from the cave and the tunnel opened to a wider space, more caves appeared before them. There seemed to be caves and tunnels dug all over this mountain. Caves connecting caves, tunnels leading to more tunnels. Each entrance had a number of demons and ghosts with a green lantern on their heads going in and out, like a giant beehive or an anthill. If Xie Lian had come in by himself, there'd be no way he'd remember the way. Yet, Hua Cheng acted like he was at home, and traversed through various tunnels and caves without hesitation, exceedingly at ease, like he knew the paths by heart. The two of them had on their green-flamed little demon skin, and no one stopped them in their paths. Xie Lian breathed in relief, but Hua Cheng thought he was sighing and asked, "What's wrong?" "Nothing," Xie Lian said. "I thought you would attack the lair head-on instead of sneaking in. I'm not too good with fighting, so I'm relieved." He meant it when he said he wasn't good at fighting. He may be skilled, but he wasn't good at dealing with the aftermath. Hua Cheng seemed to have puffed a laugh. "I did attack head-on the first time, but the moment he found out he ran away," Hua Cheng said. "This time I'm here for his person, so of course I can't have him notice I'm here." Was the person Hua Cheng wanted Chianchu to meet the Night Touring Green Lantern? Xie Lian mentally wondered, was there a relationship between the two of them? Well, whatever he wants to do, I'll still accompany him, then ask him to undo the spell later. Xie Lian still had the burning of Paradise Manor on his mind, and still felt guilty. As he was thinking, Hua Cheng spoke. "That useless trash can't do anything, but he's very vigilant. Those little demons can't approach his person, and it's not easy disguising as his closest henchman. To get close, there's only one way." Just then, four little demons came by, laughing and chatting. Hua Cheng slowed his steps, and Xie Lian followed his lead. Turns out, the little demons had behind them a train of bound humans dragged by a long rope. Among the humans, some were ragged and unkempt, some in extravagant clothes, but they all seemed to be young men and women under the age of 30. There was even a child who was grabbing onto the corner of a sleeve of one of the young men. They were probably father and son. Their hands were bound, and looking terrified, some ready to faint, while trudging through the demonic lair. They brushed past Huacheng, and without missing a beat, he turned around and seamlessly joined the end of the march. He gently elbowed Xie Lian, and he repeated Huacheng's actions. When he looked over, Huacheng had already changed skin again, and this time, it was a clean-cut young man. He himself probably looked similar. The little band made twists and turns through the tunnels and caves. The little demons leading the group seemed to be quite content in their duties, and from time to time showed off a little authority, yelling and snarling at the prisoners behind them. No funny business. No crying. With your faces all covered in tears and snot, if you ruin our great one's appetite, we'll teach you what's it like to want to die. Of the four great calamities, there had never been words that the other three supremes devoured human flesh, only the green ghost Qi Rong remained gluttonous. No wonder his equals and enemies scoffed at any mentions of him, dismissing him as unsightly and ignorant. Earlier Huacheng said there was only one way to get close to the green ghost Qi Rong, and it appeared that mixing in with the food was the way. As he walked, Xie Lian reached for Huacheng's hand. Once he succeeded in grabbing hold of it, he felt Huacheng freeze, like he wanted to pull away. It wasn't that Xie Lian didn't notice, but under the circumstances there wasn't much room for thought. He held Huacheng's hand tight and lightly drew a word in his palm, save. Since Xie Lian saw, then he must save those people. This gesture was him informing Huacheng of his intentions. After the word was written, Huacheng gently folded his fingers and closed his palm. A moment later, the band exited a tunnel and proceeded to enter an exceedingly large cave. The moment they entered the cave, a field of shadowed objects entered their vision. Xie Lian squinted and hadn't quite made out what those objects were, but instead he felt Huacheng grip his wrist and drew a few words on the back of his palm. Watch your head. Don't touch. At first Xie Lian thought there hung many rags from above, but when he looked closer, his pupils shrank. What rags? It was a field of blackened, tightly packed people, feet above, heads hung low, suspended in midair. The forest of upside-down corpses. However, although there hung those flipped dead bodies, there was no bloody rain because those corpses were all dried without a drop of fresh blood left in their veins. The expressions on those dried corpses all looked to be in pain, their mouths open wide, and there was a thin layer of snow-like crystals on their bodies and faces. It was salt. In the deepest recesses of the cave, the lights shone bright and there was a giant chair, a long table, golden goblets and jaded utensils. Such extravagance made it look more like a royal banquet hall rather than a deep mountain cave. A bit further away from the long table was an enormous steel cauldron, big enough to allow over 10 people to swim within. The cauldron was red and boiling, its contents bubbling in rage, and if anyone should accidentally fall in, it would only be seconds before they're cooked through. The four little demons ushered the group of prisoners towards the cauldron. But some fell to the ground shivering in fear when they saw what was waiting for them. And in the midst of yelling, hitting, and pulling, Xie Lian suddenly felt next to him. Huacheng's arm went stiff and stopped in his step. He turned his head to see, and saw that although Huacheng still had on the appearance of a clean-cut young man, his eyes were blazing with rage. Even though Huacheng was always smiling, Xie Lian knew his true emotions were always hidden deep within. Xie Lian had never seen in his eyes a violent fury this blatant. He followed Huacheng's sight, and the next moment, felt his own breathing stop. Before the extravagant giant chair knelt a person. In the first glance it was a person, but upon a closer look, it was actually a stone statue the size of a real person. It was a rather interesting statue sculpted in a kneeling position, its back facing him, its head downcast. It was the very form that could be described as a dog with its tail between its legs. It was easy to presume that the only purpose of making such a statue was for humiliating this person. Xie Lian didn't need to turn the statue around to know that its face must be exactly the same as his. Translator's notes. Bodhidharma doll, a hollow, round, traditional doll modeled after Bodhidharma, the founder of the Zen tradition of Buddhism. These dolls, though typically red and depicting a bearded man, Bodhidharma, vary greatly in color and design depending on region and artist. It has a design that is rich in symbolism and is regarded more as a talisman of good luck. Dharma dolls are seen as a symbol of perseverance and good luck. Wiki.